This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Well, today on Dreamland, we're talking to Von Braschler about time shifts. And this is going to be fascinating after last week. And we are going to get into the, you know, some of you will remember that Anne and I had a number of time shifts back in the mid-teens in 2009, 2010 that were really extraordinary. They were involved Starfire Tor, who is also involved in the time shift experience, and they were very real. So I welcome Von Braschler especially because having had the experience myself and reading this truly remarkable story, I know that there's something here, and it's something that's not talked about very much. And yet I bet you a lot of you, when you listen to this remarkable Dreamland, you'll think to yourself, good Lord, that's happened to me. Because it probably has. It's not uncommon. Von Braschler is an award-winning journalist. He's formerly a faculty member at the Omega Institute. He's led workshops throughout the United States and the UK. He's a member of the Theosophical Society and the author of a number of other books, including Seven Secrets of Time Travel, which we must touch on. Von, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It's an honor to be with you.
Well, yes, and it is, and we're going to have a good time today. Where did you start with this whole idea? Because when I was first made aware of time shifts, I began to notice them. And when did you begin to become aware of this? Because I think they happen a lot.
They do, and a lot of people have trouble relating to it. It's outside the frame of their normal consciousness. We have no frame of reference for this in our society. People tend to disregard you if you talk about such things. It couldn't have happened. We are so material. Everyone tries to think in terms of linear material reductionist thinking. And so there's no room for this. But it happened to me at a young age, and it continued to happen to me over and over and over. And then I realized, my gosh, I'm slipping in and out of time. And I think a lot of people do this.
I do, too. Tell us about when you first began to notice it.
Well, that actually happened when I was like 11 or 12. And when you're 11 or 12, you don't tell people that you slipped in and out of time. But mine was a doozy. I joined some friends getting on a yellow school bus. But this was in the summer, and it was to take people on this old yellow school bus to the berry field to pick berries. Well, I was a lazy little boy, and I just ate all the berries I could, turned none in, and I went swimming at the river all day long until the horn blew, and it would take us home. I loved that. it was a nice diversion. And then one day I got very sick at the berry field. I mean, really sick. And they said, what is it? It's like a pain in my abdomen. They said, well, you have a stomach ache. You've eaten too many berries. And I said, No, this is something really bad. And I think this is the thing. A lot of people will have odd situations like this when their life is in danger. And there's something inside you, your eternal life force or your spirit, your inner self, that just knows it's not safe being you inside your body at that time. Your physical life is threatened. And I begged them to take me home, and they said no. So I looked at the entrance that we drove across to get to the berry field, and every day we drive across this railroad track. And I said to myself, in kind of a delusionary frame of mind, I'll get on those railroad tracks and it'll lead me right to my home. Now, we were like a good 20 miles away from my home, And I didn't really know how I got there because I didn't pay attention. And I just had this naive idea that I could walk on the tracks and it would take me right up to my home. And I started to walk and I looked back and I waved. And then I continued to walk and I rounded a bend where I couldn't see my friends back there yelling, "Come back, come back, you're lost." And then I turned forward and suddenly I was in front of my house. It was a tremendous space-time shift. And I've tried to explain how I got there. As people say, well, maybe angels carried you. Well, I don't remember the angels. I just remember I took one step and then I was home. And I went inside, flopped on a bed. My mother came home, took me to the hospital, and my appendix were burst. So I couldn't have waited much longer to get home. Now, when I came home, it was evening. And I left shortly after noon. And it's like, I can't explain any of this, but it's like it happened instantaneously in my mind. And a year later, I was looking out at the front of the house and I realized that no railroad track stopped in front of my house. Never had, never did. I mean, they stopped at one end of the town by the river, one end of the town by the bay. This is in Everett, Washington. So a couple of years later, we moved to another home 5 miles, 6 miles north of there. And indeed, the railroad track stopped right in front of our house. I think that was a time shift.
That's a wonderful story. And now, do you think it's because you noticed this? And it's actually something that is part of ordinary experience that we kind of filter out? Or is there something about people like you? And during the period that Ann and I were having time shifts, I guess Ann and I and others who have them more frequently than we did, is there something special about those people?
Well, I tried to establish a pattern of how these things take place. I mean, it's very hard to verify them. They're all anecdotal, but there is a pattern to it, it seems. They often happen late in the day, just about dusk, or later in the afternoon. They seem to happen more often in the late summer or early fall. They seem to almost always happen when a person is entering a shift in consciousness, a consciousness shift, where they get very quiet. Often they're alone. They tune out all the internal dialogue and they just like, boom, it's like your heightened consciousness takes over. The spirit inside you leads you and you are experiencing. Very often people will hear music in this state. Very often, yes, clairaudience, they'll hear like flutes or trumpets or cymbals. Or someone singing or someone calling their name. Very often they'll take a step forward and everything looks different. They might be in the same place, but it looks like they're in a different time in that place. And sometimes, as in my case, you're in both a different time and a different place.
Now, let's do this. We usually take a break at 10 minutes and 25 minutes after the hour. So we're a little early, but this is a perfect moment to just pause for a second, Free Dreamlanders, and we're going to take a little break, and you're going to watch some fascinating commercials and or listen to them if you're listening on the audio feed. And we'll be right back.
Start to ask the question, it unfolds the fabric of space itself, how it's made, what is it made of?
We're not alone in this universe. We never have been.
Alien intelligences have cohabited with us on this planet for millions of years.
We inherited the obsession from the Anunnaki.
Anyone that still thinks that we're the ones that are obsessed with gold does not know enough about the true history of our species, how we came to be here, and the conditions that brought us here.
We are not unique in this universe. Extraterrestrials do exist. We are, so to say, the copies of them.
UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future. We're talking to Von Braschler. His book, Time Shifts, Experiences of Slipping into the Past and the Future. Now, Von, you have some wonderful stories of time shifts from the past, and I thought it would be fun to go through them. But I also want to say, folks, that we are going to... Von had a very vivid description of a certain state in which you can enter these other levels of consciousness. In his book, he has outlined just how to do that, and I've experimented with it. And, Von, I'm very into this. You look surprised, but all my guests think, oh, yeah, it's just another interview, because and they don't read the book. But you're talking to an interviewer who read the book very carefully. And now, so let's go through and have some fun with some of these fabulous stories that you collected together, like the Charlotte Moberly story from 1901. Let's just start with the beginning.
Well, that's one of my favorite stories. Charlotte Moberly was a professor, actually a college president at one of the colleges of Oxford. And in 1901, Charlotte, with her colleague, another professor, Eleanor Jordan, visited the Palace of Versailles. But on the day that they were there, there seemed to be very few people, and they wanted to enter the Trianon Gardens, and they were closed. So Charlotte and her friend Eleanor went to the Petit Trianon. This is 1901. So they crossed this funny little bridge, and they were amazed by what they saw there in the Petit Trianon Gardens. There was, people were dressed in elaborate costumes, and there was one woman sketching a picture there in the gardens. And to them, it seemed strangely out of time, and they didn't seem to have interaction with the people, and the people there didn't seem to notice them for the most part. So they left, and they returned several times to the gardens again, but they never saw it the same way. Now, when they would return, there would be more people there. They would not be alone. And they continued to talk about this. Now, these were pretty credible people. So you couldn't say they were just, you know, making up a story. They were college professors. And they wrote a book in 1911 called An Adventure. I believe it's still in print. And the British Society for Psychical Research investigated their reports. Now, they found that there was such a little bridge that they walked across, although it no longer existed in 1901. They found this looking at old maps and sketches. They also identified that the woman that they saw sketching was probably Marie Antoinette from their description, and verified that Marie Antoinette would come to these garden parties, and she would sit there at an easel, and she would sketch and paint. And they also learned that there was a French poet, who a contemporary of Marie Antoinette, named Robert Montague, and he was quite famous for establishing and organizing these elaborate costume parties. So this remains one of the gold standards, in that it took a lot of research by credible researchers to establish that the bridge they saw was indeed there, you know, in earlier times, that indeed there were. Now, they knew nothing about this. They were just visiting the Palace of Versailles and hoping to see what they could see. They had no knowledge of these parties or the bridge or Marie Antoinette and her painting. So I tried to collect stories that I thought were well reported and credible, in that they were credible witnesses and collaborated, I might add.
Well, and it's a remarkable story, and it's not alone. It's not isolated. So we're going to just go right on here. And, you know, Vaughn, you're talking to someone, but my listeners know the story. I'm not going to go into it. I had a movement back into time on a street corner in Manhattan in 1983. And I know what this is. I've done it. I've experienced it. And in my case, it was horrifying because, fascinating, but horrifying because for a while, I did not know whether or not I would even come back. And when I did get back, I ran home immediately, told my wife the whole story, and we decided that if I just disappeared, she should look in the classified ads in the old newspapers at the library in their newspaper collection from the 1870s, 80s, and 90s, which is the general period I went back to. And then we went up and looked in those newspapers thinking, could somebody have tried to contact their own lost present from a time slip that they couldn't get out of? And we also wondered about madhouses and people in insane asylums. And I wonder if you, there's not anything in the book about exploring this, but I wondered as I was reading it, if you came across any indications that there may be people who ended up trapped in their own past.
Well, it's funny you would mention that. One of my favorite books is a book by Sybil Leake, who is, of course, many things, and known as the White Witch. She was also known as a good psychologist. And she wrote a book early on called Inside the Bellevue. And she actually got herself admitted to see what it was like. Found out it was rather hard to get out. And once you get medicated and once you get herded into that environment, you were kind of like grouped into, with the other crazies. But this is what this is my takeaway from her book, Inside the Bellevue, was that people there often agreed upon what they were seeing and what they had experienced. And it was so outside of what other people would talk about that they were just considered crazy. So it's just easier for a lot of people when they have unusual experiences of a personal level just to be quiet say nothing, because otherwise they might lock you up, you know. And yeah.
So that is definitely a problem, and I guess probably people are locked up because of that, especially if somebody wandered down the street saying, "I'm not from this time."
Exactly.
Goodness knows what happens to people in this world, because, you know, a lot of people just disappear. That happens.
They disappear and they're never seen again. And, yeah. You know, mostly when people have time slips, they will shift in time and they'll come back, you know. And there's usually a time differential where it seems like they've been gone a long time, but they really weren't. Time just passes differently in this manner, and you could live a whole lifetime somewhere else and then slip back, you know. And I suspect some of us do that, but it's disconcerting for people.
No, disconcerting. That's a good word. Simply brain bending would be another way to describe it. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's go on to the Charlie Chaplin case now.
Yeah.
We're back in L.A. in 1928, folks. Yeah. Silent movies are all the rage, and Charlie Chaplin is the biggest star in the world. Tell us the story, Vaughn.
Well, Charlie Chaplin movie debut back in 1928 was a major event. You know, it's probably hard to relate to it unless you think back to people lined up to see Star Wars or something. But indeed, people were all lined up outside the theater for the debut of his new movie. And this story is interesting because it's controversial, but it's also interesting in that there are many, many witnesses to this event. They reported seeing a woman oddly dressed, unlike the rest of them, walking back and forth, almost nervously in front of the theater. And she was holding something to her head, which now we might say, well, she was talking on a cell phone. But keep in mind, this is 1928. What in the world is a cell phone? So she's talking into this little thing, seemingly, and she's holding it close to her ear, and she's talking into this little thing she holds up to her head. But people look at her oddly because they don't hear anyone talking to her. Is she talking to herself? And she seems perturbed, as though she's not communicating directly. And then she vanished. She just vanished. So all these witnesses said, yeah, we saw this strange woman walking back and forth, oddly dressed, talking into this little thing she held up to her head as though she were talking to herself. And then she just disappeared. And they went into the movie theater. So there's a lot of reports to that, in that maybe it was something they saw in the movie. No, there's nothing in the movie like that. You know, and throughout time, these stories get twisted around. But in fact, that was actually something experienced by many, many people. Now, we might wonder why she was perturbed, and why she was trying to communicate and seemingly not communicating as she spoke and held this thing to her head. And I would suggest to you this. If you slipped back into 1928 and you were walking in front of a theater in Los Angeles and you were trying to talk to somebody back in your time, well, don't you think they couldn't hear you and you couldn't hear them?
Yeah, I would think not. She was. Do you suppose there are people who literally can time travel and know it, and you're using a technology? And she was a time traveler from perhaps even the present, or who was doing it, was well aware of what she was doing?
Yes, I do think there are people. In the book, I describe various groups of people who throughout time have proven the ability to time shift, experience a reality outside normal time space. And I actually met someone, I think was a time traveler, who actually impacted my life on a flight I made from Portland, Oregon, where I then worked, to New York, where I was doing work. This was very strange. She just popped into my life and then popped out. And she seemed to know things from the future that I had never told her, and I didn't even know.
Well, tell us.
Oh, okay. We can't leave that there. Oh, I will not mention her name. But
No, don't mention any names, because my lawyer tells me I can't have the names of third parties mentioned on my show anymore, because the world has gotten too litigious.
Can I give you a first name only?
Yeah, of course.
Oh, okay. This helps tell the story more logically. I got on this plane, and it was my job at that time to visit New York publishers of magazines to do what we called one-shots. That is to say, our dream home design company in Portland was working with major New York publishers to produce once-in-a-lifetime books that would stay on the newsstand for like maybe a year. And then I would also go and try to set up a newspaper column that we're self-syndicating. So anyway, I would travel on this plane regularly from Portland, Oregon to New York or points in the East. And this flight I would take would very often stop briefly to take on additional passengers in Minneapolis. On one of these flights, I was between Portland and Minneapolis. And a flight attendant walked up to me. I remember this distinctly because she was wearing a big purple crystal, amethyst. And she came over and she said, I want to relocate you to another seat. I thought, oh, what have I done wrong? I said, of course. She puts me into a back seat. She comes to me later and says, change your meal. This is back when people actually got meals on flights.
Got meals. I remember those days. Those were nice.
It was something awful usually. And I forgot what my meal choice was. She said, I've reviewed your meal choice, and this is all wrong. I'm putting you on a better diet. And this is, I'm going to bring you a fruit platter. I said, okay. I thought, gee, that's kind of fancy. Maybe I'll get grapes. Maybe I'll get watermelon. I'm getting all excited. Like, what is this lady going to bring me? And why is she taking such an interest in me? Well, after I finish my fruit platter, she comes back and she says, you know, I need to talk to you. Is that all right? And she sits back there. And she said, you know, when you get to Minneapolis, I want to start you on yoga training. I said, yoga training? Well, I actually knew a little bit about yoga, but I'd read a little bit about it. And most of my yoga training was reading this book by Jeffrey Hodgson called A Call to the Heights, which I love. And then I thought of like the yoga teachers on television that do these stretching exercises. And I said, stretching exercises? She said, well, sure, in the beginning. She said, but there's a lot more to it. And she said, but I said, you don't understand. I don't really plan to go to Minneapolis. I've never actually been in Minneapolis. This plane stops there briefly and takes me on to New York. And then I go back home to Oregon. She said, I understand. She says, but when you get to Minneapolis, you must call me to start your training. I said, sure, but I'm not going to move to Minneapolis. She said, well, here's my card. And on the front, it said Carol in her last name. And it said flight attendant, the name of the airline. I said, oh, you're a flight attendant. She said, yes, of course. She said, turn the card over, please. And it said Colleen in the same last name. And then it said yoga instructor and a phone number. She said, call that number when you get to Minneapolis. I said, sure, but I won't ever be moving to Minneapolis. I have no interest in moving to Minneapolis. Well, I got back from that trip, and a couple weeks later, maybe three, the owner of our company flew in from Detroit, and he's meeting with us on a Monday morning, gets the whole staff together, and he says, you know, I met with my partner. His partner was also a lawyer. And he said, we decided that we're going to move the entire company to Minneapolis, Minnesota. And I go, he says, well, we've just decided.
Wow.
He says, we just decided this just this weekend, but I know it's the right thing to do because we've secured a consultant who really can help our business. And he lives in Minneapolis, and he's the retired magazine editor and publisher out there. And he knows all of this business that we're in, which is mostly publications. So he said, so everyone who moves will have a job at our new location in South Minneapolis. Everyone who doesn't will be phased out, unfortunately. I'm out of 37 people, I'm the only one who moved to Minneapolis, which was a tremendous hardship because I loved living in Oregon. So I get out there and I'm unpacking. I remember it's just about Halloween and we got 3 feet of snow. And I'm thinking like, why did I move here? And I'm thinking like, oh my gosh, that woman told me I'd be here. And I went through my wallet and lo and behold, I had the card. And I call her and I say, Carol, Colleen? She said, Vaughn? I said, yes. She said, good, you're here now. We can start your training. So I say, well, when will this be? Will it be evenings or weekends or what? She said, it's up to you. You decide. I said, well, will these be individual classes or group lessons? She said, once again, it's your choice, Vaughn. She said, I'm here for you. I said, well, is it going to cost me a lot of money or are you just offering to do it as a friend? Or she said, it really doesn't matter. You can pay me whatever you want or not at all. So I start these classes and they're fascinating. I go to the first one and I say,
well, Vaughn, yeah. This is a perfect moment to pause because we got to take our second break. And after we get back, we're going to find out about these classes. Yeah. Free Dreamlanders, listen up. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved. Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. We're talking to Von Braschler. His book, Time Shifts, Experiences of Slipping into the Past and the Future. Okay, Von, let's go on and talk about the classes.
The yoga teacher. So she says, okay, now, she says, let's start. And I say, okay, are you going to teach me stretching exercises like that lady on TV? And she said, well, if you want, she said, we'll start with some of the postures. But you understand this is just to get you into the depth of it. Eventually, I want you to get you to a state of higher consciousness. This is what yoga really strives for, this higher consciousness. This is wisdom, what's called the wisdom tradition of yoga. And so she takes me everything, a breath of fire, I pass out, she slaps me and she said, what did you see? I said, I blanked out, I saw nothing. She said, you must be aware of what's around you. She said, you pass up these great opportunities. So eventually she takes me all the way, and we do demonstrations together, and she's amazing. As she described herself, she was trained at SRF, Self-Realization Fellowship, went all the way through, top of the class, knew it all. She could teach any level of yoga, and she did. And she took me to a group of people in Minneapolis, and they were all talking at once. These turned out to be theosophists. She said, "These are your people, Vaughn." She said, "I'm going to leave you with them. You stay with them." And I read a book by a theosophist named Jeffrey Hodson. She said, "Okay." She said, "But now I'm going to leave you, and I'm going to start a yoga retreat in Oklahoma." And I never saw her again. But I must tell you that I never heard of her going to the airport again after the first time I met her either. So I wonder, how did she know all the stuff from the future? And how did she just pop in and out of my life? And how is it that she was available whenever I needed her, but never went to the airport as a flight attendant would do? Time shifters.
Ah, what a story. And do you think she actually went to Oklahoma or just disappeared?
I actually called her after that. And she said, "Our training is over, Vaughn." And she said, "You can send me some flowers if you want, but I'm not going to give you the address." No, she just disappeared. I've never heard from her again.
She slipped away into the world.
Yes.
Who knows where she may be now? How fascinating and haunting.
Probably on a plane somewhere.
Bob, and speaking of planes, why don't we go back to 1935 together? And it's a perfect moment to talk about planes in the future.
Yes, this man was an air marshal of the Royal Air Force in England, and he's flying over Edinburgh, Scotland, and there's a tremendous storm, a windstorm that pushes him over this airfield, and he looked down as he goes over it during the windstorm. And the air marshal notices that there is an abandoned airfield. There's nobody there. No planes, no ground crew. You know, weeds are growing. And then he goes a ways, and the wind seems to subside, and he turns his plane around and returns. He crosses over the same airfield. Only this time, this airfield near Edinburgh is filled with planes, but they're planes that he'd never seen. They were sleek planes. They were yellow. He'd never seen yellow planes before. And they looked modern, you know. And he looked down, and there were ground crew at the airfield. And he's used to seeing air crew at that time dressed in brown overalls. Only this ground crew is wearing blue overalls. And he's saying, "Whoa." So he gets back and he files his report and discusses it. I mean, he's a member of the Royal Air Force. And they say, no. "You never saw this. This never happened. You know, this is all in your imagination." Actually, he keeps talking about this. And doggone it, this is reported by an author, a researcher named Stefan Wagner. I'll give him credit for this. It's researched, you know, and they could find no evidence of it. But years later, lo and behold, that airfield takes on a new life. They put it back to life. They put new planes down there, which oddly are painted yellow. There's a new ground crew working the field, and they're all dressed in blue uniforms. So it would appear that Sir Victor Goddard, the Air Force Marshal, actually flew into the future and then managed to get out.
Gosh, you know, it so opens the mind to hear stories like this that are well-researched and from credible individuals like college professors or highly placed Air Force officers. And it makes you wonder where we are. And we wonder where we came from and are going, and is this the only time we will ever live in? It brings up so many stories, and I want to go on now to the disappearing house, and I want to preface that, though, folks, with a story from my own past. My family has, to this day, a country house in Texas. And one day, many things have happened there. I've had many close encounter experiences there, and some other family members have had strange things happen there, too. In any case, one day, two kids in the family, not me, I wasn't one of them, they were about 9 or 10, walked out on the front porch, and to their amazement, down at the end of the porch where there was a little, there's a pasture, it's a rural area, there was a yellow craftsman house, a big house sitting there. And they were astonished. And they ran back into the house to call my mother and tell her what they were seeing. And when they went back outside, the house was gone. Now, let's talk about another disappearing house in Oklahoma in 1971.
Yes, this is a story of three men, not just one person, three people in a white Ford pickup. And this takes place near Ponca City, Oklahoma. And like a lot of these stories, it happens in the fall of 1971. And they're dispatched by their boss to collect something on the countryside. So the three men get in this white Ford pickup, and they drive out there. And they drove through what they report as very high grass to a tank that's close to a red barn. They're very specific in what they described. High grass, see a tank, it's close to a red barn. But they realize on arriving that this tank was full of gas, and it was very heavy and hard to move, so they returned without it. But before they left, they noticed a large two-story white house with no lights on, and it was nearby. And they looked at this large two-story house, this kind of like abandoned-looking house that was dark. They thought, wonder who lives there. So they go back, and their boss then decides that he's going to go out where they were and drain this tank to make it lighter for them to retrieve in the pickup. And he does that. So when the three men returned to the tank, they didn't see the White House. They looked for the house. Where's the house? We all saw it. It's not there anymore. And they asked their boss about it. And he said he didn't see it either when he was there.
So, and yet it was there for a while. Or they were somewhere in between times where they could see perhaps into another version of reality? Could it have been a parallel universe?
It could have been a parallel universe. And that's another interesting way of looking at it. But everything seems to be operating parallel to this reality, if you think about it. I mean, you think about time as being finite and linear, and it's neither. It's infinite, and it's looped, and the future is occurring as the present is occurring, and the past is occurring. And the proof of this is that we can slip back in time or forward in time and then slip back as though we just jumped on a conveyor belt and then jumped off.
Yeah. It just slipped away. Well, like what happened to the children? They were too young to make a story like that up. And they tell it to this day. I mean, it's still very much a memory. But where was the house? It was somewhere outside of their minds, or was it?
Well, here's the thing, you know, the tall grass, it wasn't that tall when they went back later on. It was kind of like, you know, another time. It was the same place, but it was another time. And the fact that they all had noticed, took particular notice of this white house with no lights on, they described it in detail. They said it was two stories tall. It was white, no lights. And they wondered about it, and they talked about it. And yet nobody saw it again.
I wonder if no lights means that it was from an earlier time when they didn't have electricity.
Very likely. I mean, it's very likely the case, you know. And
yeah.
And we take certain things for granted, as there's always electricity or there's always cell phones. And we find these oddities when we go forward or backward in time, that things are not quite the same. And then to many people, this is very, disconcerting. Or mind-bending, if you will. And then you come back, and it's like you're reluctant to talk about it. Unless you're in a group of three men in a white Ford pickup, and you all had the same experience.
Right.
Then the three of them talk about it endlessly for years.
Of course, and as they would naturally. And the two kids in my life remember it. At least I know one of them remembers it to this day. I haven't asked the other one about it recently, but the other one remembered it 5 years ago, certainly. And they're now in their 60s.
Yeah.
So now we're going to move on. We're going to circle back to New York, and we're going to talk about the case of Rudolph Fence from 1950. And I'll tell you why I particularly want to talk about this case is for two reasons. First, after the experience I had of going back into what I think was the 1870s at the corner of Houston Street and LaGuardia Place, I was on the northwest corner. If anyone's interested in standing in the same place, you can. It was a March morning in 1983. And among the things that happened was, as I realized as the past sort of unfolded around me, two things happened. First, a little woman who only came up to my shoulder, all dressed in black, kind of brushed against me and went kind of rushing off, moving off down the sidewalk. And I heard a cry, and a man was shouting at me from across the street, and he had on a derby, and he looked pretty menacing. He looked he looked angry. And now let's talk about the case of Rudolph Fence, because it started out as fiction, but what happened then?
You know, I almost didn't include this story, but people who I had interviewed or talked to about this And I do include a lot of interviewed stories and personal stories in addition to these classics. But they said the Rudolph Fence story is a classic. And even though it's controversial, I have to include it because it's well documented and it seems credible on a lot of levels. This happens in New York City in 1950. And this was first described in Collier's Magazine, September 15th. Of 1951 by Jack Finney. And he kind of like plays it off as just kind of some odd, crazy story, right? And so that kind of started off the way the Rudolph Fence story was. But here's the story. Here's the real story, apparently. This man shows up in traffic in 1950. He's wearing a tall derby hat, a tall hat. And he's dressed in this top hat and out of date suit, like from an earlier era. And he's sporting handlebar mustache and sideburns. And he looks really confused by cars. And he's like caught in traffic. Suddenly he's caught in traffic. And he's like, they see this man, he's in the middle of a traffic jam. And he doesn't seem to relate at all to the cars or how to negotiate them. Unfortunately, this man is struck by a car and he's killed by the car. So the police pull him over to the morgue and they try to figure out who he is and what's his story. And they go through his pockets and they find in his pockets strange old coins. Some of them they couldn't even identify. Some they knew were old, early coins. They find a livery bill from a livery stable in Philadelphia. They find other documents that are early documents. They find a business card that says Dr. Rudolph Fence. Now they're wondering, did someone give him this card or is he Dr. Rudolph Fence? And why isn't there a phone number? It's like, how do you find Dr. Rudolph Fence? So they don't know what to do. They look for a missing persons report. There's no such description. And they wait and they wait. And so then they bury him. So then they start to get smart. And the police look through the phone book. And they find a Mrs. Rudolph Fence. So they go to see her. She's an elderly woman. And she says, well, my son died some time ago. He said, well, did he have a top hat and did he have a handlebar mustache? She said, no, no. But this is the way she described, this is the way my son, my husband described his father just before he mysteriously disappeared. He says, what? He said, yes. He said, my son, my husband told the story of when he was a young boy. His father, who was a doctor, Dr. Rudolph Fence Sr., he went for an evening walk. He said, I'm going for a stroll. And he goes outside, and he never comes back. Never comes back. We didn't know what to think of this. Now, this is the thing about this story that makes it almost the gold standard for time slips. This man, Dr. Rudolph Fence, was written up in a police report. We have the description of his son's widow. We have the article in Collier's magazine. So he slips out of time, and then he never gets back. It's unusual that when you don't get back.
Well, I hope so. I've always felt a little uneasy about time ever since that happened to me. Now, why was it originally published as a work of fiction? And is that actually what it is?
Yeah, it was published as a work of fiction, some crazy story, because people just couldn't accept the idea that he was a man out of time. The idea that he actually was the father-in-law of the woman the police later interviewed makes no sense. The fact that he had these old documents and early coins in his pocket made no sense. The fact that he was confused by the cars, he seemed to be a sophisticated person, even if he was dressed out of date. But why was he so confused by the cars? So I think this is the takeaway for me, is that the story of Rudolph Fence shows that certainly in 1950 and 1951, people could not accept the idea, as many cannot today, that there are time slips, that people do shift in and out of time. And it's just obviously someone's delusion or flight of fancy or imagination. It must be a daydream.
Yeah, well, people want to dismiss this sort of thing because it upsets the model of reality that we live by. I know that happened when it happened to me. That's exactly how I felt. I was terrified. But you know, something I remember about that experience was that I saw a crumpled up newspaper in the gutter right in front of my feet. And I thought to myself, my God, if I could pick this up and take this home. But when I leaned down to try to pick it up, a coldness went through my body, exactly as if ice-cold water was flowing through my body. And I simultaneously felt the most extreme sense of loneliness. I thought at the time, and it was so powerful, I just froze. And that was when the experience began to end and I began to come back. And I thought, not in that moment, but afterwards, if I had picked up that newspaper, I would have stayed there. I would have been there then. And what then might have happened to my family or to me, because they would have had the same experience this family did, of the father walking out of the house and just never coming back. And, you know, that happens. I mean, people abandon their families all the time in an ordinary way. And I would hate to have thought, and to have thought that I had just abandoned her and our little boy. Mm-hmm. So, and yet, you know, you look back on a story that strange, and the same thing happens to me that I know happens to a lot of people. I know how intense it was at the time and how I felt so overwhelmed by it. But now when I look back, it feels, I wouldn't say like fiction, but it feels strangely unreal. Like, how could that have ever happened? Mm-hmm. And yet it did. I think it did. All right. Now let's go on. Before we get in the last half hour of the show, we're going to get into some practical stuff that you've got in here, which, as I said earlier, I have tried. And I'll tell you the results of my efforts. But before that, let's talk about possible explanations for this stuff. There's a wonderful chapter, and this is a really good book. I mean, as folks, if you know, been following Dreamland for a while, you don't hear stuff on this show that's not good from good authors. And this is an excellent, very well-handled and researched book. You can do some interesting things with this. So tell us about possible explanations for time slips.
Well, I have a chapter in there where I looked at arguments against time slips, to be honest.
And it's very reasonable to do that.
And arguments to support time shifts. So first of all, against, we say, well, delusions, confusion, highly suggestible imagination, memories from one's own past. Now, that's an important thing. Is like when you get into discussions of deja vu, well, it's like, well, were you actually there, or are you just remembering something that happened when you were very young? Did you read about it? Did you see it in a movie? Was it in a magazine? Did someone discuss it? Psychic precognition of the future, but I think, you know, that's actually probably more that you actually were there. Dreaming, I think dreaming is a good way to actually access time shifting. Creative imagination.
As we'll find out.
Yeah, creative imagination. Well, imagination, it's like creative imagination is imagineering. to quote a wonderful kahuna Hawaiian shaman that I know. But then arguments to support it, you know, it's like, could be black holes or singularities, could be energy vortexes, could be raised consciousness. This is what I think it is. It could be our human ability to go outside ordinary space-time, and I think that's highly likely. You could call it astral travel, but I think it's a little more than just astral projection. You're moving in the light as energy bodies. I wrote a whole book on that, Moving in the Light. And then holes in the fabric of our perceived reality. And I think that's a good one. Because I think that there are like portals, and they come up now and then. And they come up in the late summer, the early fall, the late afternoon, approaching dusk. They happen when you're entering an altered state of personal consciousness, higher consciousness.
And I think that, well, you know, to give you an example, when one of the time slips that Ann and I had that was so very carefully researched by Starfire Tour, and folks, if you're a Dreamland or Unknown Country subscriber, you can just go on to Unknown Country and search on Starfire Tor, T-O-R. You'll find all this. In any case, it happened at the Magic Castle in Los Angeles, which is a famous abode of magicians. Of all the perfect places for a thing like this to happen. And what happened was Starfire went into the ladies' room. And Anne followed her in. And as Anne followed her in, and I think I'm getting the story right, there someone came out kind of impossibly. It wasn't, she was just suddenly there. And Starfire, the room it developed had been empty when Starfire went in. And then as Anne went in, she was aware of a presence, but not, she didn't perceive anybody there. But I saw the woman get out and walk out. And we found the woman. She was the house photographer taking pictures of people because it's a tourist place and people like to have their pictures taken there. And she had indeed been in the John, but it was very small and there was no way three people could have fit in it in the same time. Starfire and Anne exhaustively researched this. And she had just sort of popped up as Anne was walking in. And I saw this with my own eyes. It was really incredible. So there's something in the energy vortex. What do you think? What is your kind of bottom line here of why this happens?
Well, I've experienced that there are certain places in the world where from time to time, whether these are energy, like meridian grids, or whether they're portals or energy vortexes, there's certain places that seem more conducive to it. But in addition to that, you have to enter into a state of quiet, heightened awareness in order to be there. It needs a consciousness shift. And when you say that, people will say, well, of course, you're just imagining it in that case. If it's a consciousness shift, and this shows how little people understand consciousness. I mean, our entire experience from galaxies to the smallest atom is really intelligent energy, or known as consciousness or light. And how you choose to absorb it and process it and transform it within you is up to you. So not everybody has these experiences, but some people seem to get very, very good at it. And I would add that I've lived in places where a lot of other people seem to notice time shifts. They'll notice things out of time, and they'll talk about it locally with neighbors or friends and nobody else. Because it'll come up that, oh my gosh, you saw that too. And one of those things was when I was in Oregon, on Mount Hood in Oregon, I lived at near the old Barlow Trail, one of the five major Oregon trails. And we would notice on this Barlow Trail, sometimes late in the afternoon, late in the summer, we'd notice what looked like old wagon trains stopped and old pioneers, tired, gaunt, thirsty, pressing their bodies against the wagon trains for support as they sit on the ground, exhausted from the trail. We would notice this, and people would talk about it. And then we would also notice in this very same place, which was Brightwood, Oregon, we would notice Native Americans popping in and out. I mean, I experienced walking in the woods and suddenly an Indian, very tall, in beautiful costume with feathers and a lot of red and yellow and orange and brown. And he just popped in and he seemed startled to see me. And I said, "You don't belong here." And he popped out. And it's like I researched this and I found that farther up the mountain, the Warm Spring Indians would used to actually have summer retreats in Brightwood. Hence it got its name, Brightwood. And they would have retreats there because they thought the place was, you know, energetically charged or magical.
Well, we're going to talk more about that now because it's an ideal moment. We are coming to the end of the free program. So, Free Dreamlanders, as always, I urge you to subscribe and get involved in Unknown Country, which has got a rich social presence as well as a rich archive. It's an unusual place. There's no other website quite like it where you can be a participant as well as an observer and, above all, an explorer in the 20 years of programming. Much of it as extraordinary as this show has been. And so do think about, seriously think about going to unknowncountry.com and subscribing. Subscribers, we're going to keep on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.